soon.
Jamie, get your mother, please.
Well, are you?
Am I what?
Coming home soon.
Yes, immediately. Now, please get your mother.
Because, Dad, before you left, you promised that you're going to be at the parade. You haven't been here all day, so you can't miss it.
Jamie, please.
Because, Dad, when someone makes a promise, they definitely should keep it. You know, it's like what Turbo Man says. Always keep your promises if you want to keep your friends.
Enough! Enough of this Turbo Man, okay? I had it up to here with this Turbo Man. If there's anyone I don't want to have advice from right now, it's Turbo Man. Now, get your mother. I'm sorry, Jamie. Look, I didn't mean...
What would you know about keeping your promises? You never keep your promises. You never do anything you say you're gonna do. Ever!
Nothing says touching like Arnold Schwarzenegger. Very glad to have you all with us this weekend. Welcome Apple Valley and Phelan and Classic and hello Victorville. We'd love to give you some notes and move through the rest of our time together in unison. So you raise your hand, we'll give you some notes and we'll teach you through another aspect of living in the family this weekend. I would love to talk more at length about Arnold Schwarzenegger's, you know, that is a cinematic masterpiece, everyone. That is Sinbad and Arnold Schwarzenegger in a heartwarming holiday story of a father who learns to connect with his son. And this weekend, we're going to teach you through another aspect of how families can unite together. We had another clip, but then we realized maybe that one wasn't as church appropriate, and this one was more family friendly, because nothing says family like Schwarzenegger. Now, with all of that said, I'm sorry, I just realized that there was a... I actually didn't mean to make a joke about... Whatever. Okay. Let's start by talking about my shoulder. 15 years ago, I had surgery on my shoulder, and I went into the doctor, and it kept popping out of place. It wouldn't dislocate, it subluxated. So any of you that know your sports medicine, you know what I'm talking about. The rest of you are like, move on. And I went into the doctor to figure out what was going on. I was going to step out of my parents' insurance. I was graduating college, and I needed to get it fixed. And he said that there was a tendon that was too loose. He used the term baggy, and I don't know a lot about the human body, but I'm pretty sure tendons aren't supposed to be baggy. And so he said that they needed to do surgery to repair it. And I thought, oh, okay, like this is an old sports injury from when I played a sport that I wasn't big enough for. I get it, so they'll do arthroscopic. And I didn't know a lot about arthroscopic surgery other than it's magic. It's just this tiny little, you know, scope that is arthric, and it goes in and it fixes your body with minimal cutting, minimal pain, minimal damage, and then the camera comes back out and magic. And I said, so I, you know, this is my total medical knowledge at the age of 21. So we're gonna approach this arthroscopically? And he said, no, first of all, that's not a word. Second of all, what I'm going to do to fix your shoulder is actually we're going to cut it from the top around to underneath because everything's too loose in there. And I actually need a lot of scar tissue because the scar tissue, when it grows back, it's going to hold things back together in a way that arthroscopic surgery wouldn't. So as a matter of fact, I need to make a bigger cut than a smaller. And your plan A is not my plan A. As a matter of fact, your plan B is my plan A. And I was so discouraged leaving the doctor that day because I thought, what's the point of advanced medicine if you're going to do it the old school Civil War way? I mean, why are we not using these new techniques and advantages? But in his wisdom as a doctor, his plan A was my best plan. And we've been talking at length about the different things that God wants from you to develop your family into a stronger unit. And a lot of times it feels like my plan A is not always God's plan A. It feels like what God's plan is more difficult than I would have planned for myself. I would have, you know, said a magic prayer, sprinkled some, you know, blessed oil on my kids, and then magically they're wonderful and they don't need to be trained. I would have, you know, gone to one weekend seminar and magically my marriage is perfect every day. But that's my plan A. God's plan A is actually been to use people in the lives of other people. God's plan A is more difficult, more challenging, sometimes leaves a bigger scar. But in his wisdom, he's decided that people are his plan A. And so this weekend, we're talking about the power of example. And as a matter of fact, I want you to write that first thought down, is this: your example is the most dominating lesson you will teach your family. Now, Tom and Todd have been talking for the last few weeks about the idea of family, and it's more than just you to your kids. And I think that is where our minds go so often. And I think it was Pastor Todd 2 weekends ago that mentioned that the doctor or somebody referenced that his family was being added to with their first child. But so often we think of family as only when we finally do have kids. But family is bigger than that. It's grandparents, it's parents, it's siblings, it's spouses. If you're single, it is who you will marry, and eventually also, yes, children. And so as we speak all weekend about this subject of your example is the most dominating lesson you will teach your family, I would love for you to not just have in mind how I live in front of children, all right? I would love for you to consider the other people in your life, in your oikos, who are very much a part of your family. Now, there are two scriptures that we're going to read through in this first thought, that your example is the most dominating lesson you'll teach your family. And the first is this. It's Proverbs 22, verse 6. Now, the NIV is updated in the year 2011, and so this wording might not be the same wording you remember in maybe your New King James or your New American Standard, or some of you are hardcore old school. King James Bible was good enough for the Apostle Paul. It's good enough for you. And by the way, this, never mind. And this is the current wording that the translators have chosen for Proverbs 22:6. And it says, start children off on the way they should go, and even when they're old, they won't turn from it. Now, it's a very familiar scripture, and it's probably one of the most maybe catchphrase-worthy scriptures on a weekend when we're speaking to the importance of example. Now, we're going to develop the thought further than this in a minute, but for now, I want to stop and talk about this scripture. Because it's worded differently than the way I remember it. I mean, train a child up in the way he should go, and he will not depart from it. Maybe he will not soon depart from it. So I decided I would do a little bit of digging and take a look at this verse in the original words in Hebrew. And as I did, I realized I can't read Hebrew. And so then I started doing research through some other books of men who have done a lot of work and a lot of study on this. And start them off. Go ahead and throw that on our screen from now. The phrase that we translate in English, start them off, is a single Hebrew verb, okay? And it's hanak. And hanak is interesting because most of the time in Scripture, in the Old Testament, hanak was used not train or start them off, but it was more often used dedicate. Like, it was always used in conjunction with an inanimate object. And so it's interesting to say hanak your children, because you would only hanak something that was inanimate. Now, some of you are thinking, well, I got two kids that are very inanimate. It still works for them. But you would hanak a home. Like, you would dedicate a home. Or you, this is probably the best way to understand, like, the wider range of this verb. You would dedicate the temple. And so do you remember, maybe you do, maybe you don't, Moses dedicating the initial temple that they had and all the different elements that were in the temple, the altar and the basin and all of these different things that the priests would move through as they moved into worshiping God. And I don't know if you remember the weekend that I stood on stage with an Old Testament prof, and he talked us through that sacrificial system. And it was interesting because all the things that Moses did to dedicate the temple, there were habits and practices that he did to dedicate the temple, to hanak the temple. It involved a lot of blood. As you read back through the original account, and even like the book of Hebrews recalls that story, both stories, what floats to the surface is a lot of blood. Now, this is important because what you would do to dedicate a temple always matched up with what you wanted the temple to do. Okay? I promise, even though that sounds redundant and simple, it is very important. Now let's talk about Solomon, and he was going to dedicate the temple. And there's a couple references to that story in the books of history in your Old Testament, Kings and Chronicles. And each of those accounts records all the different ceremonies, the practices and habits that Solomon put into place to hanak that grander temple, the big, nice one that David wanted to build, but God said, no, not you, your son. Solomon had tens of thousands of animals that he sacrificed. so that, when they opened the temple, the practices and habits of the dedication matched up with the practices and habits of what the temple would wind up doing. Now, when Solomon writes the book of Proverbs in the 22nd chapter in the 6th verse, and he says, "Hanak your children in the way they should go, and when they're old they won't depart from it," it's almost like he's using bad grammar. But intentionally so. I mean, maybe if you're a construction person, I would say to you, rebar your kids in the way they should go, and they won't depart from it. Now, I know you're thinking like, "Ooh, smack my kid with rebar." No. I mean, strengthen your kids, gird them. I think that I'm going to use the same kind of language that maybe isn't good grammar, but it's good theology, and I want you to write this down. Example your children in the way they should go, and they won't soon depart from it. This is maybe a good way to understand the unique use of that word in the Hebrew. And the idea is this: sometimes we get busy as husbands, as wives, as parents, as siblings, and we're not always able to live out in front of our loved ones the things that we want to be living out. And so all of a sudden there will go 6, 8, 9 months where we haven't really stepped into the example God has called us to be for our families. And all of a sudden we'll go maybe to a church service or to, you know, a Women of Faith event, something like that, and we'll feel bad about it, and we'll come back and we'll want to make a grand gesture, some sort of big dedicatory event that says, okay, we're getting back on track in our walk with God, wife, husband, kids. And I'll say this, that the accumulation of small habits and practices will lead to a perpetuation of those habits and practices. It's really difficult, particularly in the lives of those closest to you, that when there's a total absence of any sort of habit and practice that is godly, and then all of a sudden you want to make up ground with one huge one, it tends to not be as effective as a bunch of simple ones. It is just praying for dinner with your family. Well, that's not super spiritual. I want to do something grand. There's a lot of value in hanaking your children in the way they should go. Just the regular practices and habits that you want them to have when they're older, you do them now. If you want your marriage to be godly, are you doing godly things in your marriage? I know these ideas are extremely simple, but the idea of Proverbs 22:6, and even in particular that verb, is you do the things you want done. And I think that's a very simple and plain way to say it. Now, it's interesting to note, though, that, again, I think this idea of living out an example in front of one to our minds most quickly goes to parents in front of their kids. Actually, it is not the only place in the Bible where it speaks about an example influencing another family member. Look at this scripture in 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 1 and 2. Very interesting here as well. Peter says, "Wives, in the same way, submit yourselves to your own husbands, so that many of them who do not believe, or excuse me, if any of them do not believe the word, they may be won over without words by the behavior of their wives, when they see the purity and reverence of your lives." Ladies, I don't know if there's ever been a more intimidating thought spoken to you than this, that God's plan A is to use your character to draw your husband to himself. But this isn't the only place in the New Testament where it says that. Paul is speaking to the Corinthians, and he starts speaking to the women. And, you know, it's fascinating how things that were happening here 2,000 years ago happen here 2,000 years later. And women come in and they say, "My husband isn't an example. Can you speak to him?" And we're like, "We do speak every single weekend. He can watch it on his phone or watch it on the computer. Or maybe he can come here on a Christmas or maybe on an Easter." We speak. And then you read the New Testament and it says in 1 Peter, "Ladies, your example is the sort of thing that will draw your unbelieving husband's heart to God." And it's like, whoa, that is heavy. Can't we do it arthroscopically? Can't you just send Tom to my house and have him fix my husband? That'd be great. I mean, it'd be maybe just easy. We would literally just go through the phone book in the desert, send the pastors out, and we'd magically fix everybody. But we all know that's not the case. the people who are most important in your life carry the most weight. And so now the scriptures say, and it's interesting too, because the scriptures speak in a lot of places about the importance of the role of a husband, that he carries the weight of the spiritual leadership of the home on his shoulders. I think it's fascinating, ladies, that 1 Peter and 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and chapter 7 speak about your ability through your godly example to lead your husband to Christ. That's a high calling. It's a high expectation, I know. But it's fascinating that two different men writing to two different groups had the same idea going on. And so we're going to carry this idea further out then, past kids to spouses, singles. If you are single in our church and you always lament, there's no godly dudes, there's no godly women around here. Let me just say this, that in the same way, if you want your kids to be godly, you be godly. If you want your spouse to be godly, you be godly. You want to find a godly spouse? Sorry, singles, you got to be godly. Because the godly ones are going to look at you and say, oh, no, that's not the one, and keep looking until they see in you what you want to see in someone else. That's the way this works. And so this very simple, this very basic idea that an example sets the course that is the most dominating lesson is important for parents. It's important for spouses. It's important for spouses with unbelieving spouses. It's important for singles. This is, well, it's part of a bigger spiritual picture that we're building to. So let's keep moving. There are two pictures in our PowerPoint. And for those of us in Apple Valley and Phelan and in Classic, I'm going to try and stand close to the TV. This idea, before we move on, don't click. Before we move away from this simple idea, your example is the most dominating lesson you'll teach your family. I'm going to present to you two different scenarios. This man is going to show up to his woman, okay? You tell me which of these two men, it's the same man, which of these two scenarios the woman would rather see, all right? Complex, I don't know if you're going to be able to pick up the distinct nuance between the two images, but here we go. Image number one. Husband shows up at home and he says, I almost bought you flowers today. Says it with a smile, says it right to her face, just heart to heart. It's like, man, I almost prioritized you today. Isn't that good news? Because we always say what? It's a thought that counts. And obviously he had the thought. Doesn't this count? He even said words to her face. Some of you ladies are like, I wish he would just talk to my face when he gets home. This is it. Or would you rather have this? Husband number two shuts his mouth and hands her flowers. I think someone in this room right now is clapping. I think this is obvious that between words and actions, I mean, the first one almost seems bad to do, doesn't it? It almost seems like, well, don't say it's stupid if you didn't do it. Now, why is it so obvious in two overly simplistic cartoons that you read the first one and you cringe when you read the word almost? Oh, bro, why would you say you almost did something when you didn't do it? Well, because we do that all the time, right? We drop our kids off in youth group or childcare, and we're kind of telling them, I almost lived it this week. Why don't you get it right? We show up in church and we sit next to a spouse and we know that we're just not prioritizing God. God is not the center of your home because you're not making him. It's like, I almost did it. Almost. Here, listen to Tom talk. He'll talk about it better than I do it. And we laugh at this, but we don't live it. All right, so then here's the two things I want to tell you then. Two pieces of advice, or two realities and advice in light of them, okay? Bad news and good news. The first is this. Your example is going to be negative, okay? And I want to start with the bad news because I'd like to end with the good. And really, I'd like to prove this and, you know, spend some time, you know, logically explaining that none of us are perfect and we all set bad examples. But I think of everything I've ever said on our church stage, this is the most obvious thing I could possibly have said, right? We're all on board with this. At some point in your life with someone you love, your example has been negative. And I'm willing to bet if God gives you more than 30 more minutes of life beyond this point, at some point in the future, in the life of your loved ones, your example will be negative. Now that I've proven my point, we can move on. There are two pieces of advice that I would give you in light of this. The first one is this. Find other believers to fill in your gaps. Find other believers to fill in your gaps. This is a very plain way of saying something that I want to build to. This is my theological center point for the weekend. Sanctification is a word that is both just a biblical term that is used in the New Testament, and it is also a larger theological idea that Christians have come to understand over the centuries of church life. And it is the idea that at the moment in time you let go of your life and give yourself to God, you are justified. You have been declared pure by Jesus. Okay? That is justification. So in that moment, thief on a cross dies. He looks at Jesus. He doesn't even say A, B, C. You can tell that there has been an admission in his heart when he says, there's reason for us to be on the cross. And then you can tell he believes something about Christ when he looks at him and acknowledges that there is no sin in him. He yells at the other thief and he says, can't you see this man has done nothing wrong? And then he chooses to yield his dead, sinful body to Christ when he says, when you go to heaven, could you please remember me? It is this admission, this belief, and this choice all wrapped up in a moment. And Jesus says, today you'll be with me in paradise. That is an illustration of justification. That in a flash of belief, when you let go of yourself and you trust yourself to Christ, that God justifies you. He declares you pure. There's another term that is sanctification. And that is just as an important of a term. But for those of us who have endured past our moment of salvation, it's a more difficult idea. And it is the idea that God is growing you into the image that he designed you to be. It's restoring the image of Christ in you. And so all of the trouble, the angst, the ups and the downs as you pursue God, and some of the things you get right and some of them you get wrong, all of that is molded by Christ. God sanctifies you. He's setting you apart. Now, Orthodox theology places high importance on the work of the Holy Spirit in your life concerning sanctification. God himself dwells with you. It says in many places. The book of Ephesians says the Holy Spirit is so committed to you, he seals you until the day of redemption. And so I don't know if you hated dropping your kid off on the first day of kindergarten because you were worried about maybe, is they going to pee their pants? Or are they going to remember to go to the bathroom? Or maybe you were worried about bullies. And you've never in your life thought about hitting a child until you thought about a bully maybe hitting yours. And you thought, I will stand in the gap and protect my child. And you didn't necessarily plan to get violent. But if necessary, if there was a big first grader, you'd throw down for the sake of your kid. The Bible says that the Holy Spirit seals you. God is so protective of you that his Spirit seals. And he is the one who we typically speak of concerning sanctification. And this is good. This is proper. Deciding the difference between God's role and our role in sanctification, God wins every time. However, there is a second truth that is important. And this is why I mentioned the shoulder surgery, why he was more invasive than I wanted him to be. The truth is that concerning your sanctification, God has designed other people to help you along the way. It's part of his design. I would like to spend more of our time this weekend just developing a theology of the body of Christ. But it's only part of this bigger idea, and so we're going to reference a scripture in a moment and continue to move on. But I'm almost as uncomfortable saying this as I was the weekend about the fact that God is my friend, because I thought, God, I'd rather leave you high and powerful and strong than bring you down. You're not like my other friends. But as I read the New Testament, as I read the Old Testament, I'm like, you know what, God, you say you're my friend, so I submit and I let it change the way I see you. And as I prepared this last couple weeks for our time together, God says in a number of places that his Spirit sanctifies you. And you know who else does? Other believers. The book of Ephesians. In the fourth chapter, verse 16, it says this: from him, meaning Christ, the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work. Now that's important. That phrase begins to teach you the theology of believers' role in sanctification. Let me say it plainly this way. Husbands, are you perfect? No. Then why isn't your woman going to like Women of Faith or the Women's Retreat? Why doesn't she go to a ladies' small group, something like that? Like, well, because I'm all she needs. I don't know that that's quite right. I've seen you in traffic and she needs more than you're able to provide. And that's this big, hairy, scary secret. Oh, no, there's no way. Yeah, you're right. Okay. Well, because the biblical view of that is that the whole body works together to grow the whole body. And so the reason the doctor cut from top to bottom is he wanted the scar tissue to help my tendon hold my shoulder. Shoulder was the problem. Tendon was the culprit. Flesh scar was going to be part of the answer. Like, well why is that? Well, because this whole thing works together. This is as complicated as any car engine out there. All the things that happen just in this area. And God says each part builds each part. It's the way it is. It's the way I've designed it. If you're uncomfortable with that, I'm sorry. You need to build a bridge and get over it. You need to buy a turkey and stuff it. Because I'm telling you, other believers help other believers grow. You can be all high and mighty on your own. Run your solo act if you want to. That's the Hebrew word is dumb. And God says he will grow you by using other yous. Well, I don't like that. Well, sorry. I don't care if you don't like it. It's all over in the New Testament. And here's the good news. It is the answer for your weaknesses. In those areas of your life where you set a bad example, you know what? Have your man go off to men's retreat and just spend a weekend with other bros and just like so he can laugh about his crazy family because you know what? He's noticed you're crazy. And he can just pray, he can worship, and come back equipped. I don't know why you wouldn't want your kids regularly involved in a Hang 10 group or a tribes group or an ABS group at our church. Those of you on our other campuses to be involved in youth ministries there. I don't know why you wouldn't want that. Because you as mom and dad are perfect? No, you're not. No big deal. Why don't you step into a biblical understanding of sanctification? That it involves both the work of the Spirit and the work of the body being the church. And so find other believers to fill in the gaps where you fall short. My wife and I are part of a small group, and she regularly spends time with those other ladies because she's married to me. And so there are a lot of gaps that need to get filled in. And God has been gracious to us as a family to provide those other people. We need to keep moving. Second thing I want to say is this, is include your weakness in your time with God. Maybe this is the most just personal, well, I'll share something real personal at the end. I tend to downplay my weaknesses and upplay my strengths. I don't know if you're the same way, but that's me. I tend to think I work real hard. I tend to think that I am more patient. I tend to think that I am not as mistake-filled as I really am. And I can easily blind myself to the spots in my life as a husband, as a father, as a brother, where I don't set an example that I should. And that makes me more ineffective. And it is those moments where I'm in prayer, in reading, in worship, where I'm talking with God, and it's hard for me to spend time praying, reading, or worshiping when my weaknesses don't come to the surface. And I've decided as much as I can that I want to spend time talking with my Father about my weaknesses. Because then when I do, well, let me read you something. Psalm 139:23 says, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts." The psalmist uses another word there. Another verb is bakan, and bakan is the same word God used about himself in Malachi when he says, "Test me in this. See if I, if you give to me, see if I won't give back to you." And I thought, oh, that's interesting. Why would God say to test him, and then David says, "God, why don't you test me?" Apparently, there is a sort of relationship between God and man where we can see each other's trustworthiness. And when God speaks into my life and I say, "God, why don't you check out what's going on? Show me the ways I'm not trustworthy." He helps me become what I'm not. This is the big, hairy, scary secret. This is the wizard behind the curtain. This is the truth. that because you set a bad example, why don't you just talk with father, your father about it? I don't understand why we feel we have to perform most in those times when it's just us and God. I mean, he's the one who knows most already. And so if there is a burden on your shoulders to make excuses or dance around your weaknesses when you're spending time with God, let me just give you permission. God, David, they said back and forth, you know, this dynamic relationship. I know God to Malachi, but God says, why don't you test my trustworthiness? And David's pretty bold and says, God, why don't you test mine too? Let's have it go both ways. And I'm telling you guys, as you spend time with God in prayer, in reading, and in worship, talking about your weaknesses, sharing them with him, probably one of the most effective things I could tell you this weekend. But let's keep moving on. I'd like to talk about the positives that are true about your example. Your example will be positive. And I want to say this way. What you live each week, you teach each week. Now, you go to a church where Tom Mercer has been here for about 30 years, and he's pretty good at explaining things. I don't know if you've noticed that. Todd, Arnett, here been here for a decade, and he's pretty good at explaining things. On your campuses, Kurt and Brian and Tim and Classic, they're pretty good at explaining things. Sometimes you guys get downgraded and I'm here, but it's easy for you to associate growth in Christianity with a good explainer, because churches almost exclusively are built around a communicator. And that's just the way church life works. And so it's easy for you to think, well, I'm not good about talking about God. And so I'm not really the grower in my family. I'm not growing my spouse. I'm not growing my kids. I'm not growing this fiance or this boyfriend, girlfriend I have. That's not my job. Yes, it is, because what you live each week is what you teach each week. And I'm going to prove it to you this way. I'm going to take one practice or habit, okay? All the way back to Hanak. One practice or habit in your life, church attendance. So simple. Just be there and don't die, okay? Now, I'm going to inject three different scenarios into your life and watch what happens out the back end when you stick to this habit. You go to church regularly, and then somewhere in your season of family, you as the man lose your job. And you think, God, why'd you do this to me? I'm going to keep my distance from you. And you stop going to church. Or you keep going to church. And it's a place where you bring it up and you pray. You write it down on your forms. It comes with you in your faith. And your kids see it. And your kids don't know how much they should worry or not. They're kind of clueless. And when they get here, they're like, yay, I get to go to my friends again. But over the years, they watch you bring your lost job with you in your faith. Or maybe you go to church and then this happens. Your mom gets cancer and you're hurt. You're scared. In a lot of ways, your mom has been your anchor in your life. And thinking about the fact that she's been anchor or God wants to be your anchor, you're just conflicted by that. There's probably a more mature way of saying it, but you'd rather stay loyal to your mom than God, and so you quit on God because you're frustrated with him that it happened to your anchor. Or you decide, you know what, my mom has been such an anchor placed in my life by God, who is my absolute anchor. And so because of my anchor that gave me this one, I'll stay close with him. And you know what, we're going to take a two-hour break each week from caring for my mom, and we're going to be here because it's where we need to be. Or maybe it's your marriage, and it's low, it's rocky, it's rough. And I know right now the mantra in evangelical world is we want to maintain a biblical view of marriage. You know our government doesn't have a biblical view of marriage, right? No fault divorce, that's not biblical. Prenuptial agreements, it's not biblical. And so if we want to make a case for biblical marriage, I'll give you the best possible way to do it. Let your marriage be an example. That's the best way to make a case for biblical marriage. I'm sorry, it'd be easier to make a commercial or an ad, but your marriage would be the best way. And your kids watch you guys fight, and they watch you show up at church, and you feel, oh, this is hypocritical. We shouldn't even be here. We're fighting. We're just fake. Really? Or are you just normal like the rest of us? Because the rest of us have our ups and downs too, and we drag our sorry selves in here, and we sit down, and we think, God, you need to fix this, because I need you right now. You see, it's, well, throw these phrases up on our screen if you could. You see, in each of those scenarios, here's what you're teaching your family. God's our provider. God is trustworthy. God loves forgiveness. Wouldn't you want your spouse to have these at the core of who they are? Don't you think it would center them, level them out? I do. I think it would. Wouldn't you love your kids to have this? When they're looking for a spouse, you want them to look for these things. Well, Tim, I've never said those things to my kids. Okay, well, first of all, I just gave you three phrases. Teach your kids these things. But second of all, do you see how the one habit in practice, how when you set an example, when you example your kids, when you example your husband, when you example your wife, how you are teaching this every week. This is what your life teaches, or you teach, unfortunately, the opposite. But we're in the positive category, and so I'm telling you, yay for you. When you step back into your church environment, wherever it is that you worship, and you say, God, I am here. I am confused, I am scared, I am doubtful, but God, I am here. You are saying in a way that is more persuasive than Tom or Todd or myself or any of your campus pastors, God is able to be trusted. God loves forgiveness, and so I will keep looking for that. God is our provider. And whether I see it or not, I trust it. You speak these things in a way that is powerful to your family when you stick in your habits and practices that you want to have as a habit and a practice. All the way back to the beginning. Your actions plus your words are more important than any other lesson. And that's just the way it is. And I'm going to end with telling you a story of failure on my part, because I am more acquainted with my failures than my successes, because there is a wide sea to choose from. I think it was like 8 or 9 days ago, somewhere around there. I think my wifey was actually maybe out with the girls from our small group, actually. And I was home with the kids. And I had prepared dinner for them, meaning it was a Costco chicken. And we have a kitchen island, and I put the chicken on the island, not the dining table, the island. And then the kids and I, four kids, we got 2, 7, 8-month-old puppies. Matter of fact, can we show everyone the puppies right now? There they are. My puppies are awesome. They are good doggies, okay? This one is Rocky, and I don't know if we got a shot or not, everybody. Yeah, okay, maybe here. And then this one is Anna. Rocky is a boy, Anna's a girl. I don't know, this is going to sound like I'm picking favorites. Rocky's a good boy, Anna is a pretty girl, okay? And we're all outside hanging out, and they're brother and sister, born on the same day. And rescues, they're adorable. Rocky is a good boy, but he also can't quite stay away from Anna when she's making trouble. Like, he's just there. And so we're all outside, and Rocky knows how to open the slider. He just flicks his little paw, and then they get in. I have no idea how she get it. But Anna is up on the island with the chicken, and she knocked it off, and now she's down on the island. And I walk in, and there's chicken juice everywhere. A third of the chicken is gone, and it was not my most holy moment, okay? And in a humble frustration, I grabbed Anna by the collar and I put her in the hall closet it was the closest place I could put her, and I closed the door, and then I'm looking back at the chicken like, I gotta get this cleaned up right now. And in the back door was Judah, my 8-year-old. Judah is a black and white, there's no gray in him, okay? And he's absolutely right, it was the wrong thing for me to do to put Anna in the hall closet. Judah loves the puppies. And honest to goodness, he was angry with me. And he walked out the back door. It was like one of those moments where I'm like, doggone it! Judah spent $6 on the chicken! And $8, whatever it was. And so I left the chicken on the floor. I went on the back patio. And Judah is loyal. And that's a good thing. He had the right reaction. I did not react the right way. I really didn't. And I said, Judah, why are you mad? You're not supposed to treat the dog that way, Dad. And I said, you're right. What should I have done? You should have told her that was wrong, put her in the crate so she could still see that you weren't mad at her, and then clean up the chicken. I'm like, doggone it. That was perfect. And so here's what I did. I took a negative example I set. And I said, you know what, Judy, you're right. I'm sorry. I'll go do that now. And I went back over to the hall closet. Anna had never been in the hall closet. And she's like, what the heck happened? One moment I'm eating chicken, Dad, that was delicious. And now I'm staring at the vacuum. And I walk her over to the crate, and I put her in her crate, which is not a place of shame or frustration or anger. It's where she goes when she's supposed to not be on the island. And I cleaned it up, and later on, I had to apologize. Not the triumphant moment that Pastor Dad wanted to have with the son, who he named after this biblical tribe that Christ would come through. My son, Judah, looks at me and he saw a failure. Okay, what am I going to do? Pretend it never happened? Or decide, you know what? God, how I handle this right now will probably be one of the most lasting lessons I teach my son. So here's what I'll do with my failure. I'll settle my heart and I'll submit. And that story is important twofold. You walk out of the auditorium you're in right now and you walk to an example you're going to set. You know that, right? You got to make it the sort of lesson that will draw that fiance closer to your heart, that will draw your spouse closer, that will pull your kids closer to the habits and practices you want for them anyway. You got to do it now. Hanak your children in the way they should go and they won't depart from it. Or you'll walk out and you'll refuse to acknowledge you have any weaknesses. You refuse to acknowledge that you ever set a bad example. Refuse. And you know what? You'll just keep pushing them further, and they'll start looking for examples somewhere else. I think the calling on our lives this weekend at HDC is to let God's plan A to be a little more messy, to be a little more scarring, a little more difficult. But for you to grab a hold of the fact that your example is the most dominating lesson that you'll teach your family. Let's pray. Father, we pray for ourselves. God, this week, we don't ask that your glory would shine through us. We don't ask that you would ripple across our valley and redeem. God, I ask that you would reach into individual hearts in this church and communicate clearly to us what example right now do I need to either continue because it's desperately important, or what example do I need to reverse? God, speak to individual hearts. And if you are so bold as to trust your good doctor with an area in your life that is weak and keeps popping out of place, I'm willing to bet that his brilliance will tell you right what you need to do. And you just got to be gutsy enough to listen. And also, those of you who are in our church and you've never given your life to Christ, you have not trusted God with who you are. Believe it or not, me and the dog and the chicken is a perfect example for you. You have to acknowledge in this moment, brother or sister, that you have wronged a holy God. And the accumulation in your life of sin is too much for you to overcome yourself. At HDC, we see admit your sin. In a humbling way, I admitted my sin to my son. I want you in this moment to admit it to your father. And at HDC, we say what the Bible says, that you have to believe that Jesus gives you purity, that he forgives because of his atoning sacrifice. And we want you right now in this church to choose to follow Christ, to make yourself part of his family by submitting to his leadership and following. God, we pray that you would use our lives in the way you designed them to work. As each part does its work, Lord, we will build the body. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.